Hey, how's it going, you fiends?
I'm Demi Bobemi.
And I'm dead inside. And welcome back to another episode of Brisingr.
Kind of felt like you were going to say Eragon for a second.
I felt like it. COVID edition. Quarantine edition.
Whoa.
This gets a special...
quarantine sticker on the front of your door.
What?
What? You said it gets a special... and I said a quarantine sticker on the front of your door.
Yeah. Oh, we should draw a little quarantine sign in the back
on the chalkboard. I don't even know what that looks like. I mean, I feel like I have a blurry general idea of yellow and black, and there's like a, you know. I don't know, man. Do whatever you want.
I will for the next episode. Panna said, Brisingr 19. Okay. What did I just say? I said welcome back. So, mm-hmm. Demi, give us a recap.
Ooh. It's gonna be rough. Ready? Go. Okay, so the first chapter of the last episode that we read was Brom's hologram, Bromogram, telling Eragon that you're my son and I love you. That's pretty cool. And then Eragon said, wow, I'm all fucked up inside. And then we learned about the hearts of dragons. That's an empty stone that they can put their consciousness in.
Remember and by what they're they, called?
I mean, no. And then, I'm panicking! You fucked me up! Why would you ask me a question when I'm trying to give a recap? Why the fuck would you do that?
That's why.
There you have it.
They're called Eldunari.
Yep. I would have said something in Jidum because my brain panicked.
Degrimst in Jidum? Yep, that's a pretty good synopsis of what happened, except for that last little 5 seconds you could have squeezed out of there that you were panicking for.
Could have, because when have questions been allowed during a recap?
We should have like an edit overlay that's like panic mode. And it's like, whoop, whoop, whoop. And it's like, Demi panic. Before we get started, before we get to reading, announcement. You guys ready? So during the quarantine, as soon as I get my new graphics card installed, I'm going to be streaming again on twitch.tv/deadinside. But also, additionally, Demi and I together will also be streaming on twitch.tv/deadinside, and we might multi-stream to YouTube as well. But what we're going to do is we're going to play a game for the channel and then upload it to the channel in segments, and then once it's all complete, just upload the entire thing. So we'll do like 2 hours of like a stream where we're playing a game on Twitch together. I felt like that was going to be a lot more of an announcement, but you know, like it was going to be longer. That was pretty quick.
Cool.
Good for me on how to articulate better. Chapter 49, Hands of a Warrior. Eragon nibbled on a warm, sweet strawberry while he stared into the fathomless depths of the sky. With whose eyes was he staring into the depths? When he finished eating the berry, he set the stem on the tray before him, pushing it into just the right spot with the tip of his forefinger, and then opened his mouth to speak. That is how you speak. I guess in a world of mind speak, it is an important difference, observation, detail to say his mouth he spoke with.
Yeah, I guess.
Before he could, Oramus said, "What now, Eragon?" "What now? We have spoken at length on those subjects about which you are curious. Curious. What now do you and Saphira wish to accomplish? You cannot linger in Elismira, so I wonder what else you hope to achieve by your visit, or is it your intention to depart again tomorrow morning?" "We had hoped," Eragon said, "that when we returned, we would be able to continue our training as before. Obviously, we haven't time for that now, but there is something else I would like to do." And that would be, Master, I have not told you everything that happened to me when Brahm and I were in Tirm. And then Eragon recounted how curiosity had lured him into Angela's shop and how she had told him his fortune and the advice Solemnbaum had given him afterward. Sad butt.
I'm glad you cleared that up. I wasn't sure who you were talking about.
You're welcome. Ormus drew a finger across his upper lip, his demeanor contemplative. I have heard this fortune teller mentioned with increasing frequency throughout this past year, both by you and in Arya's reports from the Varden. This Angela seems to be most adept at turning up whenever and wherever events of significance are about to take place. That she is, confirmed Saphira. Continuing, Ormus said, her behavior reminds me very much of a human spellcaster who once visited the halls of Elismira, although she did not go by the name of Angela. Is Angela a woman of short stature, with thick, curly brown hair, flashing eyes, and a wit that is as sharp as it is odd? You have described her perfectly, said Eragon. Is she the same person? Ormus made a small flicking motion with his left hand. If she is, she is an extraordinary person. As for her prophecies, I would not devote much thought to them. Either they will come true, or they will not. And without knowing more, none of us can influence the outcome.
It's such an annoying thing to say. Like, I get it. Like, either it is or it isn't. But, like, that's annoying.
You either is or you ain't.
Fine, Ormus, whatever.
What the werecat said, though, is worthy of far more consideration. Unfortunately, I cannot elucidate. Is that the right way to say that?
I don't know.
Elucidate? Hey, Google. How do you pronounce elucidate?
That's pronounced elucidate.
Okay. Google confirmed. Unfortunately, I cannot elucidate either of his statements. I have never heard of any such place as the Vault of Souls, and while the Rock of Cuthien strikes a familiar chord in my memory, I cannot recall where I have encountered the name. I will search my scrolls for it, but instinct tells me I will find no mention of it in Elvish writings. What of the weapon underneath the Manoa tree? I know of no such weapon, Eragon, and I am well acquainted with the lore of this forest. In all of Duwelden Varden, there are perhaps only two elves whose learning exceeds my own where the forest is concerned. I will inquire of them, but I suspect it will be a futile endeavor. When Eragon expressed his disappointment, Ormus said, I understand that you require a suitable replacement for Zarok, Eragon, and this I can help you with. Besides my own blade, Naegling, we elves have preserved two other swords of the Dragon Riders. They are Arvindur and Tamerlane. Arvindur is currently held in the city of Nadendel, which you have not the time to visit, but Tamerlane is here in Elismira. It is a treasure of House Valtheros, and while the lord of their house, Lord Fjolar, would not part with it eagerly, I think he would give it to you if you asked him respectfully. I will arrange for you to meet with him tomorrow morning. And what if the sword does not fit me? Asked Eragon. Let us hope it does. However, I shall also send word to the smith Runon that she may expect you later in the day. But she swore she would never forge another sword, Ormus sighed. She did, but her advice would still be worth seeking out. If anyone could recommend the proper weapon for you, it would be she. Besides, even if you liked the feel of Tamerlane, I'm sure Runon would want to examine the sword before you left with it. Over 100 years have elapsed since Tamerlane was last used in battle, and it might need some slight refurbishing. Could another elf forge me a blade? Asked Eragon. Nay, said Ormus. Not if it were to match the craftsmanship of Zarok, or whichever stolen sword Galbatorix has chosen to wield. Runon is one of the very oldest of our race, and it is she alone who has made the swords for our order. She is as old as the riders? Asked Eragon, amazed. Older even. Eragon paused. What shall we do between now and tomorrow, master? Ormus looked over Eragon and Saphira, then said, Go and visit the Manoa tree. I know you will not rest easy until you have. See there if you can find the weapon the werecat enticed you with. When you have satisfied your curiosity, retire to the quarters of your treehouse, which is on Zondi servants keep in readiness for you and Saphira. Tomorrow we shall do what we can.
What was that?
I don't know. Weird clicking sounds. Ghosts. But Master, we have so little time, and the pair of you are far too tired for any more excitement today. Trust me, Eragon, you will do better for the rest. I think the hours between will help you digest all we have spoken of. Even by the measure of kings, queens, and dragons, this conversation of ours has been no light exchange. Despite Oremus's assurances, Eragon felt uneasy about spending the remainder of the day in leisure. His sense of urgency was so great, he wanted to continue working even when he knew he ought to be recuperating. Recuperating?
Well, it's like, what is he possibly going to do, like, work-wise? It's not like he can just telecommute to work, you know? Can't just hop on his laptop and beep, boop, bop, you know? But, like, what is he going to do?
Who knows?
Nothing. Take a resort day.
Put yourself in quarantine for a day. Eragon shifted in his chair, and by the motion he must have revealed something of his ambivalence, for Oremus smiled and said, "If it will help you relax, Eragon, I promise you this. Before you and Saphira leave for the Varden, you may pick any use of magic, and in the brief while we have, I will teach you everything I can concerning it."
Hmm.
With his thumb, Eragon pushed his ring around his right index finger and considered Oremus's offer, trying to decide what, of all areas of magic, he would most like to learn. At last he said, "I would like to know how to summon spirits."
Wow, that, of all the magics he could have picked.
A shadow passed over Oremus's face. "I shall keep my word, Eragon, but sorcery is a dark and unseemly art. You should not seek to control other beings for your own gain. Even if you ignore the immorality of sorcery, it is an exceptionally dangerous and fiendishly complicated discipline. A magician requires at least 3 years of intensive study before he can hope to summon spirits and not have them possess him. Sorcery is not like other magics, Eragon. By it, you attempt to force incredibly powerful and hostile beings to obey your commands, beings who devote every moment of their captivity to finding a flaw in their bonds so that they can turn on you and subjugate you in revenge. Throughout history, never has there been a shade who was also a rider, and of all the horrors that have stalked this fair land, such an abomination could easily be the worst, worse even than Galbatorix. Please choose another subject, Eragon. One less perilous for you and for our cause."
Like, of all the ones to pick, like, he picked the most
interesting.
Well, yeah, okay, it's the most interesting, but it's not the most practical, you know? Like, he picked the one that could, like, potentially put everyone in danger.
Total Eragon move. Classic Eragon. "Then," said Eragon, "could you teach me my true name?"
Okay.
"Your requests," said Oremus, "grow ever more difficult, Eragon Fenariel. I might be able to guess your true name if I so wished." The silver-haired elf studied Eragon with increased intensity, his eyes heavy upon him. "Yes, I believe I could, but I will not. A true name can be of great importance, magically, but it is not a spell in and of itself, so it is exempt from my promise. If your desire is to better understand yourself, Eragon, then seek to discover your true name on your own. If I gave you it, you might profit thereof, but you would do so without the wisdom and you would otherwise acquire during the journey to find your true name. A person must earn enlightenment, Eragon. It is not handed down to you by others, regardless of how revered they be." Eragon fiddled with his ring for another moment, then made a noise in his throat and shook his head. "I don't know. My questions have run dry." "That, I very much doubt," said Oremus. Eragon found it difficult to concentrate upon the matter at hand. His thoughts kept returning to the Eldenari and to Braum. Again, Eragon marveled at the strange series of events that had led Braum to settle in Carvajal, and eventually to Eragon himself becoming a dragon rider. If Arya hadn't, Eragon stopped and smiled as a thought occurred to him. Will you teach me how to move an object from place to place without delay, just as Arya did with Saphira's egg? Oremus nodded. An excellent choice. The spell is costly, but it has many uses. I'm sure it will prove most helpful to you in your dealings with Galbatorix and the Empire. Arya, for one, can attest to its effectiveness. Get it, Eragon? Do you get it?
Does he get it, though?
Lifting his goblet from the table, Oremus held it up to the sun, and the radiance from the above... What? And the radiance from above rendered the wine transparent. He studied the liquid for a long while, then lowered the goblet and said, "Before you venture into the city, you should know that he whom you sent to live among us arrived here some time ago." Remember?
Yeah.
A moment passed before Eragon realized to whom Oremus was referring. "Sloane is an Ellesmira?" said Eragon, astonished. "Yeah, you fucking sent him there. How long do you think it would fucking take him to get there? Like, years?"
I forgot he existed. What?
I keep smelling like smoke.
Like... from the heaters, or...
Mm-mm. Like candle smoke. Maybe it's my breath.
It's not my breath.
I think it's, like, a mixture of the coffee and, like, just electronic smell together. I'm hungry. He lives alone in a small dwelling by a stream on the western edge of Ellesmira. Death was close upon him when he staggered out of the forest, but we tended the wounds of his flesh, and he is healthy now. The elves in the city bring him food and clothes, and otherwise see to it he is well cared for. They escort him wherever he wishes to go, and sometimes they read to him, but for the most part, he prefers to sit alone, saying nothing to those who approach. Twice he has attempted to leave, but your spells prevented it. I'm surprised he arrived here so quickly, Eragon said to Saphira. The compulsion you placed upon him must have been stronger than you realized. Aye. In a quiet voice, Eragon asked, have you seen fit to restore his vision? We have not. The weeping man is broken inside, Glader said. He cannot see clearly enough for his eyes to be of any use. Should I go visit him? Asked Eragon, unsure of what Oremus and Glader expected. That is for you to decide, said Oremus. Meeting you again might only upset him. However... you are responsible for his punishment, Eragon. It would not be wrong for you to forget him. No, Master, I won't. Again. He didn't say again. I added that.
Well, you're not wrong.
With a brisk motion of his head, Oremus set his goblet on the table and moved his chair closer to Eragon. The day grows old, and I would keep you here no longer, lest I interfere with your rest. But there is one more thing I wish to attend to before you depart. Your hands. May I examine them? I would like to see what they say about you now. And Oremus held out his own hands toward Eragon. Extending his arms, Eragon placed his hands, palm... Wait, what? Extending his arms, Eragon placed his hands, palm downward, on top of Oremus's, shivering at the touch of the elf's thin fingers against the inside of his wrists. The calluses on Aragorn's knuckles cast long shadows across the backs of his hands as Oremus tilted them from side to side. Then, exerting a slight but firm pressure, Oremus turned Aragorn's hands over and inspected his palms and the undersides of his fingers. "What do you see?" asked Eragon. Oremus twisted Aragorn's hands around again and gestured at his calluses. You now have the hands of a warrior, Eragon. Take care they do not become the hands of a man who revels in the carnage of war.
Oh.
That was it.
That was so abrupt, I felt like.
Yeah.
Damn. I just keep thinking about his, like, knuckles.
Get rid of that shit, boy.
It's, like, grossing me out the more I think about it.
Probably waiting until he has a replacement weapon.
So he doesn't have to just, like, punch people to death anymore? Because what did he want those for?
To punch people to death. He was inspired by the neural curling or whatever from the dwarves.
Nails or something.
Studs, yeah.
I just think of them as, like, big, giant, like, warty-looking things.
I mean, they would be. Like, imagine, like, a callus on your hand just big. Extended on your knuckle.
It's pretty gross. Like, he's never getting a girlfriend looking like that.
He's never getting Arya looking like that. He's never getting Arya.
Period.
Period. Water time. The next chapter.
Whoa.
I gotta moisten up my teeth.
Ew.
Chapter 50, The Tree of Life. From the crags of Telnir, Saphira flew low over the swaying forest until she arrived at the clearing wherein stood the Minoa tree. Thicker than 100 of the giant pines that encircled it, the Minoa tree rose toward the sky like a mighty pillar, its arching canopy thousands of feet across. The gnarled net of its roots radiated outward from the massive, moss-bound trunk covering more than 10 acres of forest floor before the roots delved deeper into the soft soil and vanished beneath those of lesser trees.
I'm sorry, 10 acres?
Yeah. What?
That's, like, huge.
Help.
What the fuck? Like, 10 acres is so much.
Yeah. Damn. That is a fucking massive ass fucking tree.
Kind of reminds me of in The Last Avatar. Why do I keep saying Last Avatar? The Last Airbender? That big giant tree in the swamp that's, like, connected to everything.
Yeah, but that was, like, a quarter acre.
It's not a quarter acre.
Quarter acre.
It was huge.
No. Not 10 acres.
Well, wait, is it the tree is 10 acres or its roots go out 10 acres? Acre. God damn it.
Gnarled net of its roots right out of moss-bound trunk covering more. Oh, okay, yeah, it's roots. Okay. Because I just read moss-bound trunk. Moss-bound trunk covering 10 acres. And I was like, but it's net. It's its roots as well. Okay. That's more manageable. Stop.
What are they doing out there?
Scraping the side of our house away. Close to the Minoa tree, the air was moist and cool, and a faint but constant mist drifted down from the mesh of needles above, watering the broad ferns clustered around the base of its trunk. Red squirrels raced along the branches of the ancient tree, and the bright calls and chirrups of hundreds of birds burst forth from the bramble like depths of its foliage. And throughout the clearing, the sense of a watchful presence pervaded, for the tree contained within its remnants of the elf, once known as Linnea, whose consciousness now guided the growth of the tree and that of the forest beyond. Eragon searched the uneven field of roots for any sign of weapon, but as before, he found no object he would consider carrying into battle. He pried a loose slab of bark from the moss at his feet and held it up to Saphira. "What do you think?" he asked. "If I imbued it with enough spells, could I kill a soldier with this?" "You could kill a soldier with a blade of grass if you wanted to," she answered. "However, against Murtag and Thorn, or the king and his black dragon, you might as well attack them with a strand of wet wool as that bark." "You're right," he said, and tossed it away. "It seems to me," she said, "that you should not need to make a fool of yourself in order for Solemnbum's advice to prove true." "No, but perhaps I should approach the problem differently. If I'm going to find this weapon, as you pointed out before, it could just as easily be a stone or a book as a blade of some sort. A staff carved from the branch of the Minoa tree would probably be a worthy weapon, I would think. But hardly equal to a sword. No. And I would not dare lop off a branch without permission from the tree herself, and I have no idea how I would go about convincing her to grant my request." Saphira arched her sinuous neck and gazed upward at the tree. Then she shook her head and shoulders to rid herself of the droplets that had accumulated on the sharp edges of her faceted scales. As a spray of cold water struck him, Eragon yelped and jumped backward, shielding his face with his arm. If any creature tried to harm the Minoa tree, she said, I doubt they would live long enough to regret their mistake. For several more hours, the two of them prowled the clearing. Eragon continued to hope that they would stumble across some nook or cranny among the knotted roots where they would find the exposed corner of a buried chest that would contain a sword. Since Murtag has Zarok, which is his father's sword, Eragon thought, by all rights, I ought to have the sword Runon made for Braum. It would be the right color, too, Saphira added. His dragon, my namesake, was blue as well. At last, in desperation, Eragon reached out with his mind toward the Minoa tree and attempted to attract the attention of her slow-moving consciousness, to explain his search and ask for help. But he might as well have been trying to communicate with the wind or the rain, for the tree took no more notice of him than he would of an ant flailing its feelers by his boots. Disappointed, he and Saphira left the Minoa tree, even as the rim of the sun kissed the horizon. From the clearing, Saphira flew to the center of Ellesmira, where she glided to a landing within the bedroom of the tree house the elves had given them to stay in. The house was a cluster of several globular rooms that rested in the crown of a sturdy tree, several hundred feet above the ground. A meal of fruit, vegetables, cooked beans, and bread was waiting for Eragon in the dining room. After eating a while, Eragon curled up next to Saphira on the blanket-lined basin set into the floor, ignoring the bed in preference for Saphira's company. He lay there, alert and aware of his surroundings, while Saphira sank into a deep sleep. From his place by her side, Eragon watched the stars rise and set above the moonlit forest and thought of Braum and the mystery of his mother. Late in the night, he slipped into the trance-like state of his waking dreams, and there he spoke with his parents. Eragon could not hear what they said, for his voice and theirs were muted and indistinct, but somehow he was aware of the love and pride his parents felt for him, and although he knew they were no more than phantoms of his restless mind, ever after he treasured the memory of their affection.
Aww.
How very sentimental.
Harry Potter.
We love you, Harry. Thanks. At dawn, a slim elf maid led Eragon and Saphira through the paths of Ellesmira to the compound of the family Valtheros. As they passed between the dark boles of the gloomy pines, it struck Eragon how very empty and quiet the city was compared with their last visit. He described only three elves among the trees, tall, graceful figures who glided away on silent footsteps. When the elves marched to war, Saphira observed, few remained behind. Aye. Lord Fiolar was waiting for them inside an arched hall illuminated by several floating werelights. His face was long and stern and angled more sharply than those of most elves, so that his features reminded Eragon of a thin-bladed spear. He wore a robe of green and gold, the collar of which flared high behind his head like the neck feathers of an exotic bird. In his left hand, he carried a wand of white wood carved with glyphs from the Leduin Kvedi. Mounted upon the end was a lustrous pearl. Bending at the waist, Lord Fiolar bowed, as did Eragon. Then they exchanged the elves' traditional greetings, and Eragon thanked the lord for being so generous. And Eragon thanked the lord for being so generous as to allow him to inspect the sword, Tamerlane. And Lord Fiolar said, long has Tamerlane been a prized possession of my family, and it is especially dear to my own heart. Know you the history of Tamerlane, Shade Slayer? You like my lord voice?
Yeah, it's pretty lordly.
No, said Eragon. My mate was the most wise and fair Nuadra, and her brother, Arva, was a dragon rider at the time of the fall. Nadra was visiting with him in Illyria when Galbatorix and the Forest Horn did sweep down upon the city like a storm from the north. Arva fought alongside the other riders to defend Illyria, but Kielandi of the Forest Horn dealt him a mortal blow. As he lay dying on the battlements of Illyria, Arva gave his sword Tamerlane to Noadra so that she might protect herself. With Tamerlane, Noadra fought free of the Forsworn and returned here with another dragon and rider, although she died soon afterward of her wounds. That's riveting sad. Story.
It's sad, though. It's like, here's a thing to protect yourself. She died anyway.
At least she got the sword back.
This poor guy.
With a single finger, Lord Fyler stroked the wand, eliciting a soft glow from the pearl in response. Tamerlane is as precious to me as the air in my lungs. I would sooner part with life than part with it. Unfortunately. Oh, no. What?
He's gonna have to kill this dude to get his sword.
Unfortunately, neither I nor my kin are worthy of wielding it. Tamerlane was forged for a rider, and riders we are not. I am willing to lend you it, Shadeslayer, in order to aid you in your fight against Galbatorix. However, Tamerlane will remain the property of House Faltheros, and you must promise to return the sword if ever or my heirs ask for it. Eragon gave his word, and then Lord Fyler led him and Saphira to a long, polished table grown out of the living wood of the floor. At one end of the table was an ornate stand, and resting upon the stand was a sword, Tamerlane, and its sheath. The blade of Tamerlane was colored a dark, rich green, as was its sheath. A large emerald adorned the pommel. The furniture of the sword had been wrought of blued steel. A line of glyphs adorned the crossguard. In Elvish, they said, "I am Tamerlane, bringer of the final sleep." In length, the sword was equal to Zerok, but the blade was wider, and the tip rounder, and the build of the hilt was heavier. It was a beautiful, deadly weapon, but just by looking at it, Eragon could see that Runon had forged Tamerlane for a person with a fighting style different from his own, a style that relied more on cutting and slashing than the faster, more elegant techniques Braum had taught him. As soon as Aragorn's fingers closed around Tamerlane's hilt, he realized that the hilt was too large for his hand, and at that moment he knew that Tamerlane was not the sword for him. It did not feel like an extension of his arm, as had Zerok. And yet, despite his realization, Eragon hesitated, for where else could he hope to find so fine a sword? Arvindr, the other blade Oromus had mentioned, lay in a city hundreds of miles distant. Then Saphira said, "Do not take it. If you are to carry a sword into battle, if your life and mine are to depend upon it, then the sword must be perfect. Nothing else will suffice. Besides, I do not like the conditions Lord Fyler has attached to his gift." And so Eragon replaced Tamerlane on its stand and apologized to Lord Fyler, explaining why he could not accept the sword. The narrow-faced elf did not appear overly disappointed. To the contrary, Eragon thought he saw a flash of satisfaction appear in Fyler's fierce eyes.
Well, good. I'm glad everyone got what they wanted.
Oh my god, I should have checked this chapter before I started reading it.
Yeah, your stomach's about to eat itself.
I'm hungry. I'm gonna wither up and die. From the halls of the family of Altheros, Eragon and Saphira made their own way through the dim caverns of the forest to the tunnel of dogwood trees that led to the open atrium in the center of Runon's house. As they emerged from the tunnel, Eragon heard the clink of a hammer on a chisel, and he saw Runon sitting at a bench by the open-walled forge in the middle of the atrium. The elf woman was busy carving a block of polished steel that lay before her. Whatever she was sculpting, Eragon could not guess, for the piece was still rough and indistinct. "So, Shadeslayer, you are still alive," said Runon, without taking her eyes off her work. Her voice grated like pitted millstones. "Ormus told me that you lost Zerok to the son of Morzan." Eragon winced and nodded, even though she was not looking at him. "Yes, Runon Elda. He took it from me on the burning plains." "Humph." Runon concentrated on her hammering, tapping the back of her chisel with inhuman speed, and she paused and said, "The sword has found its rightful owner, then. I do not like the use to which... What is his name? Ah, yes. Murtag is putting Zerok. But every rider deserves a proper sword. and I can think no better sword for the son of Morzan than Morzan's own blade. The elf woman glanced up at Eragon from underneath her lined brow. Understand me, Shadeslayer. I would prefer it if you kept hold of Zarok, but it would please me even more if you had a sword that was made for you. Zarok may have served you well, but it was a wrong shape for your body. And do not even speak to me of Tamerlane. You would have been a fool to think you could wield it. As you can see, said Eragon, I did not bring it with me from Lord Fyler. Runon nodded and resumed chiseling. Well then, good. I love Runon. If Zarok is the right sword for Murtagh, said Eragon, wouldn't Braum's sword be the right weapon for me? A frown pinched Runon's eyebrows together. Undbitter? Why would you think of Braum's blade?
She don't know yet? I thought...
He's about to spill that tea.
Ooh!
Because Braum was my father, said Eragon, and he felt a thrill at being able to say that.
Aw, that's so cute.
Is that so now? Laying down her hammer and chisel, Runon walked out from under the roof of her forge until she stood opposite Eragon. Her posture was slightly stooped from the centuries she had spent hunched over her work, and because of it, she appeared an inch or two shorter than he. Yes, I can see the similarity. He was a rude one, he was, Braum. He said what he meant and wasted no words. I rather liked it. I cannot abide how my race has become. They are too polite, too refined, too precious. Ha! I remember when elves used to laugh and fight like normal creatures. Now they have become so withdrawn. Some seem to have no more emotion than a marble statue. Saphira said, Are you referring to how elves were before races joined themselves to one another? Runon turned her scowl onto Saphira. Bright scales. Welcome. Yes, I was speaking of a time before the bond between elves and dragons was sealed.
Whoa.
The changes I have seen in our races since, you would hardly credit as possible, but so they are. And here I am. One of the few still alive who can remember what we were like before. Then Runon whipped her gaze back to Eragon. Unbitter is not the answer to your need. Braum lost his sword during the fall of the Riders. If it does not reside in Galbatorix's collection, then it may have been destroyed, or maybe buried in the earth somewhere, underneath the crumbling bones of a long-forgotten battlefield. Even if it could be found, you cannot retrieve it before you would have to face your enemies again. What then should I do, Runon Elda? Asked Eragon, and he told her of the falchion he had chosen when he was among the Varden, and of the spells he had reinforced the falchion with, and of how it had failed him in the tunnels underneath Farthendor. Runon snorted. No, that would never work. Once a blade has been forged and quenched, you can protect it with an endless array of spells, but the metal itself remains as weak as ever. A rider needs something more. A blade that can survive the most violent of impacts, and one that is unaffected by most magic. No. What you must do is sing spells over the hot metal while you are extracting it from the ore, and also while you are forging it, so as to alter and improve the structure of the metal. How can I get such a sword, though? Would you make me one, Runon Elda? The wire-thin lines on Runon's face deepened. She reached over and rubbed her left elbow, the thick muscles in her bare forearm writhing. You know I swore I would never create another weapon so long as I live. I do. My oath binds me. I cannot break it, no matter how much I might wish to. Continuing to hold her elbow, Runon walked back to her bench and sat before her sculpture. And why should I, Dragon Rider? Tell me that. Why should I loose another soul reaver upon the world? Choosing his words with care, Eragon said, Because if you did, you could help put an end to Galbatorix's reign. Would not it be fitting if I killed him with a blade you forged when it was with your swords he and the Forsworn slew so many dragons and riders? You hate how they have used your weapons. How better to balance the scales than by forging the instrument of Galbatorix's doom? Runon crossed her arms and looked up at the sky. A sword. A new sword. After so long, to again ply my craft. Lowering her gaze, she jutted her chin out at Eragon and said, It is possible, just possible, that there may be a way I could help you, but it is futile to speculate, for I cannot try. Why not? Asked Saphira. Because I have not the metal I need, Renan growled. You do not think that I forged the rider's swords out of ordinary steel, do you? No. Long ago, while I was wandering through Duwelden Varden, I happened upon fragments of a shooting star that had fallen to the earth.
Oh my god.
The pieces contained an ore unlike any I had handled before, so I returned with it to my forge, and I refined it, and I discovered that the mix of steel that resulted was stronger, harder, and more flexible than any of earthly origin. I named the metal Bright Steel on account of its uncommon brilliance, and when Queen Tarmanora asked me to forge the first of the rider's swords, it was Bright Steel I used. Thereafter, whenever I had the opportunity, I would search the forest for more fragments of the star metal. I did not often find any, but when I did, I would save them for the riders. Over the centuries, the fragments became ever more rare, until at last I began to think none were left. It took me 4 and 20 years to find the last deposit. From it, I forged 7 swords, among them Undbitter and Zerok. Since the riders fell, I have searched for Bright Steel only once more, and that was last night, after Oremus spoke to me about you. Runon tilted her head, and her watery eyes bored into Eragon. I wandered far and wide, and cast many spells of finding and binding, but nothing came across, not a single speck of Bright Steel. If some could be procured, then we might begin to consider a sword for you, Shadeslayer. Otherwise, this discussion is no more than pointless blathering.
I love this woman.
Eragon bowed to the elf woman and thanked her for her time. Then he and Saphira left the atrium through the green leafy tunnel of dogwood. As they walked side by side toward a glade from which Saphira could take off, Eragon said, Bright Steel. That has to be what Sullenbaum meant. There must be Bright Steel underneath the Manoa tree.
Fuck.
How would he know? Perhaps the tree told him herself. Does it matter? Bright Steel or not, she said. How are we supposed to get at anything that the roots of the Manoa tree cover? We cannot chop through them. We do not even know where to chop. I have to think about it.
What if they talk to the tree, figure out where it's at? Or they could tunnel underneath of it, maybe. Nah, there'd be too many roots. What's happening?
There's just a lot more pages left. From the glade by Runon's house, Saphira and Eragon flew over Elismira back to the crags of Talnar, where Oremus and Glader were waiting. Once Saphira had landed and Eragon climbed down, she and Glader leaped off the cliff and sprawled high overhead, not really going anywhere, but rather enjoying the pleasure of each other's presence.
Aww.
While the two dragons danced among the clouds, Oremus taught Eragon how a magician could transport an object from one place to another without having the object traverse the intervening distance. Most forms of magic, said Oremus, require ever more energy to sustain as the distance between you and your target increases. However, that is not the case in this particular instance. It would require the same amount of energy to send the rock in my hand to the other side of that stream as it would to send it all the way to the Southern Isles.
Whoa.
For that reason, the spell is most useful when you need to transport an item with magic across a distance so vast it would kill you to move it normally through space. Even so, it is a demanding spell, and you should only resort to it if all else has failed. To shift something as large as Saphira's egg, for example, would leave you too exhausted to move. Then, Oremus taught Eragon the wording of the spell and several variations on it. Once he had memorized incantations to Oremus's satisfaction, the elf had him attempt to shift the small rock he was holding. As soon as Eragon uttered the spell in its entirety, the rock vanished from the palm of Oremus's hand, and, an instant later, reappeared in the middle of the clearing with a flash of blue light, a loud detonation, and a surge of burning hot air. Eragon flinched from the noise and then gripped the branch of a nearby tree to steady himself as his knees buckled and cold crept over his limbs.
Whoa.
His scalp tingled as he gazed at the rock, which lay in a circle of charred and flattened grass, and he remembered the moment when he had first beheld Saphira's egg.
That's cool.
Well done, said Oremus. Now, can you tell me why the stone made that sound when it materialized in the grass? Eragon paid close attention to everything Oremus said, But throughout the lesson, he continued to ponder the question of the Manoa tree, even as he knew Saphira did as she soared high above. The longer he considered it, the more he despaired of ever finding a solution. When Oramus had finished teaching him how to shift objects, the elf asked, "Since you have declined Lord Filer's offer of Tamerlane, will you and Saphira stay in Illismira much longer?" "I don't know, master," replied Eragon. "There is much more I wish to try with the Manoa tree, but if it does not succeed, then I suppose we will have no choice but to depart for the Varden empty-handed." Oramus nodded. "Before you leave, return here with Saphira one last time." "Yes, master." As Saphira winged her way toward the Manoa tree with Eragon on her back, she said, "It didn't work before. Why should it now?" "It will work because it must. Besides, do you have a better idea?" "No, but I like it not." "We do not know how she might react. Remember, before Linnea sang herself into the tree, she killed the young man who betrayed her affections. She might resort to violence again." "She won't dare. Not while you are here to protect me."
She's like, I don't know if I'm going to, though.
"Don't know if I can beat a 10-acre tree."
It's a big tree.
Big boy. With the faint whisper of wind, Saphira alighted upon a knuckle-like root several hundred feet from the base of the Manoa tree. The squirrels in the enormous pine screamed warnings to their brethren as they noticed her arrival. Just like the little fucking Dak rats. We like come near and they're like... Sliding down onto the root, Eragon rubbed his palms on his thighs, then muttered, "Right, let's not waste time." With light footsteps, he ran up to the root of the trunk of the tree, holding his arms out on either side to maintain his balance. Saphira followed at a slower pace, her claws splitting and cracking the bark she trod over. Eragon squatted on a slippery patch of wood and hooked his fingers through a crevice in the trunk of the tree in order to keep himself from toppling over. He waited until Saphira was standing above him, and then he closed his eyes, breathed deeply of the cool, moist air, and pushed his thoughts out toward the tree. The Manoa tree made no attempt to stop him from touching her mind, for her consciousness was so large and alien and so intertwined with the other plant life of the forest, it did not need to defend itself. Anyone who attempted to seize control of the tree would also have to establish their mental dominance over a large swath of Duwelden Varden, a feat which no single person could hope to achieve. From the tree, Eragon felt a sense of warmth and light, and the earth pressing against her roots for hundreds of yards in every direction. He felt the stir of a breeze through the tree's tangled branches and the flow of a sicky sap seeping over a small cut in its bark, and he received a host of similar impressions from the other plants the Manoa tree watched over. Compared with the awareness it had displayed during the Blood Oath celebration, the tree almost seemed to be asleep. The only sentient thought Eragon could detect was so long and slow-moving it was impossible to decipher.
I don't know why that reminded me of... it's like the most viscous liquid in the world that, like, that sap or whatever it is, or the tar that, like, drops and it, like, takes, like, 10 years for it to, like, drop or some ridiculous thing.
I think it would just, like, harden by the time it dropped.
But it doesn't.
Whoa.
It's weird. That's just what that reminded me of.
Summoning all of his resources, Eragon flung a mental shout at the Manoa tree. "Please listen to me, oh great tree. I need your help. The entire land is at war. The elves have left the safety of Duwelden Varden, and I do not have a sword to fight with. The werecat Sullenbum told me to look under the Manoa tree when I needed a weapon. Well, that time has come. Please listen to me, O Mother of the Forest. Help me in my quest." While he spoke, Eragon pressed against the tree's consciousness, images of Thorn and Murtagh and the armies of the Empire. Adding several more memories to the mix, Saphira bolstered his efforts with the force of her own mind. Eragon did not rely on words and images alone. From within himself and Saphira, he funneled a steady stream of energy into the tree, a gift of good faith that he had hoped would arouse the Manoa tree's curiosity. Several minutes elapsed, and still the tree did not acknowledge them, but Eragon refused to abandon their attempt. The tree, he reasoned, moved at a slower pace than humans or elves. It was only to be expected that it would not immediately respond to the request. We cannot spare much more of our strength, said Saphira, not if we are to return to the Varden in a timely fashion. Eragon agreed, and reluctantly stemmed the flow of energy. While they continued to plead with the Manoa tree, the sun reached its zenith and then began to descend. Clouds billowed and shrank and scuttled across the dome of the sky. Birds darted over the trees, angry squirrels chattered, butterflies meandered from spot to spot, and a line of red ants marched past Aragon's boot, carrying small white larvae in their pincers. Then Saphira snarled, and every bird within hearing fled in fright. "Enough of this groveling," she declared. "I am a dragon, and I will not be ignored, not even by a tree."
Whoa.
"No, wait," Eragon cried, sensing her intentions, but she ignored him. Stepping back from the trunk of the Manoa tree, Saphira crouched, sank her claws deep into the root underneath her, and with a mighty wrench tore three huge strips of wood out of the root. "Come out and speak with us, elf tree," she roared. She drew back her head like a snake about to strike, and a pillar of flame erupted from between her jaws, bathing the trunk in a storm of blue and white fire. Covering his face, Eragon leapt away to escape the heat. "Saphira, stop," he shouted, horrified. "I will stop when she answers us." A thick cloud of water droplets fell to the ground. Looking up, Eragon saw the branches of the pine trembling and swaying with increasing agitation. The groan of wood rubbing against wood filled the air. At the same time, an ice-cold breeze struck Aragon's cheek, and he thought he felt a low rumble beneath his feet. Glancing around, he saw the trees that ringed the clearing seemed taller and more angular than before. They seemed to be leaning inward, their crooked branches reaching toward them like talons. And Eragon was afraid.
She done pissed the tree off.
"Saphira," he said, and sank into a half-crouch, ready to either run or fight. Closing her jaws and thus ending the stream of fire, Saphira looked away from the Manoa tree. As she beheld the ring of menacing trees, her scales rippled and the tips rose from her hide like the ruff on a riled cat. She growled at the forest, swinging her head from side to side, then unfolded her wings and began to retreat from the Manoa tree. "Quick, get on my back!"
What? So you're going to start a fight and you're not even going to finish it?
Why? How do you fight a forest?
Why would you start a fight with a forest?
She wanted to not be ignored by the tree, because she is a dragon.
Now you're not being ignored. Good job.
Before Eragon could take a single step, a root as thick as his arm sprouted out of the ground and coiled itself around his left ankle, immobilizing him. Even thicker roots appeared on either side of Saphira and grasped her by the legs and tail, holding her in place. Saphira roared in fury and arched her neck to lose another deluge of fire. The flames in her mouth flickered and went out as a voice sounded in her mind in Aragon's, a slow, whispering voice that reminded Eragon of rustling leaves. And the voice said, "Who dares to disturb my peace? Who dares to bite and burn me? Name yourselves, so I will know who it is I have killed."
Ooh.
Eragon grimaced in pain as the root tightened around his ankle. A little more pressure, and it would break the bone. "I am Eragon, Shadeslayer. And this is a dragon with who I am bonded, Saphira Brightscales." "Die well, Eragon Shadeslayer and Saphira Brightscales." "Wait," Eragon said. "I have not finished naming us." A long silence followed. Then the voice said, "Continue." "I am the last free dragon rider in Alagazia, and Saphira is the last female dragon in all of existence. We are perhaps the only ones who can defeat Galbatorix, the traitor who has destroyed the riders and conquered half of Alagazia." "Why did you hurt me, dragon?" the voice sighed. Saphira bared her teeth as she answered. "Because you would not talk with us, elf tree, and because Eragon has lost his sword, and a werecat told him to look under the Manoa tree when he needed a weapon. We have looked and looked, but we cannot find it on our own." "Then you die in vain, dragon, for there is no weapon under my roots." Desperate to keep the tree talking, Eragon said, "We believe the werecat might have meant bright steel, the star metal Runon uses to forge the blades of the riders. Without it, she cannot replace my sword." The surface of the earth rippled as a network of roots that covered the clearing shifted slightly. The disturbance flushed hundreds of panicked rabbits, mice, voles, shrews, and other small creatures from their burrows and dens and sent them scampering across the open ground toward the main body of the forest. Out of the corner of his eye, Eragon saw dozens of elves running toward the clearing. their hair streaming behind them like silk pennants. Silent as apparitions, the elves stopped underneath the boughs of the encircling tree and stared at him and Saphira, but made no move to approach or to assist them. Eragon was about to call with his mind for Oremus and Glader when the voice returned. The werecat knew whereof he spoke. "There is a nodule of bright steel ore buried at the very edge of my roots, but you shall not have it. You bit and burned me, and I do not forgive you." Alarm tempered Aragon's excitement at the hearing of the ore's existence. But Saphira is a last female dragon," he exclaimed. "Surely you would not kill her." "Dragons breathe fire," whispered the voice, and a shudder ran through the trees at the edge of the clearing. "Fires must be extinguished." Saphira growled again and said, If we cannot stop the man who destroyed the dragon riders, he will come here, and he will burn the forest around you, and he will destroy you as well, elf tree. If you help us, though, we may be able to stop him." A screech echoed among the trees as two branches scraped against each other. "If he tries to kill my seedlings, then he will die," said the voice. "No one is as strong as the whole of the forest. No one can hope to defeat the forest, and I speak for the forest." "Is not the energy we gave you enough to repair your wounds?" asked Eragon. "Is it not compensation enough?" The Minoa tree did not answer, but rather probed at Aragon's mind, sweeping through his thoughts like a gust of wind. "What are you, rider?" said the tree. "I know every creature that lives among this forest, but never have I encountered one like you." "I am neither elf nor human," said Eragon. "I am something in between. The dragons changed me during the Blood Oath celebration." "Why did they change you, rider?" "So that I could better fight Galbatorix and his empire. I remember I felt a warping in the world during the celebration, but I did not think it was important. So little seems important now, save the sun and the rain."
"Okay."
"Okay."
Eragon said, "We will heal your root and trunk if that will satisfy you, but please, may we have the bright steel?" The other trees creaked and moaned like abandoned souls, and then, soft and fluttering, the voice came again. "Will you give me what I want in return, Dragon Rider?" "I will," Eragon said without hesitation. Whatever the price, he would gladly pay it for a rider's sword. The canopy of the Minoa tree grew still, and for several minutes all was quiet in the clearing. Then the ground began to shake, and the roots in front of Eragon began to twist and grind, shedding flakes of bark as they pulled aside to reveal a bare patch of dirt, out of which emerged what appeared to be a lump of corroded iron, roughly 2 feet long and 1.5 feet wide. As the ore came to rest on the surface of the rich black soil, Eragon felt a slight twinge in his lower belly. He winced and rubbed at the spot, but the momentary flare of discomfort had already vanished. Then the root around his ankle loosened and retreated into the ground, as did those that had been holding Saphira in place. "Here is your medal," whispered the Minoa tree. "Take it and go." But Eragon started to ask. "Go," said the Minoa tree, its voice fading away. "Go." And the tree's consciousness withdrew from him and Saphira, receding deeper and deeper into itself until Eragon could barely sense its presence. Around them, looming pines relaxed and resumed their usual positions. "But," Eragon said out loud, puzzled that the Minoa tree had not told him what she wanted.
"She either took something from him or put something into him."
Still perplexed, he went over to the ore, slid his fingers under the edge of the metal-laced stone, and hoisted the irregular mass into his arms, grunting at its weight. Hugging it against his chest, he turned away from the Minoa tree and started the long walk toward Runon's house. Saphira sniffed the bright steel as she joined him. "You were right," she said. "I should not have attacked her." "At least we got the bright steel," said Eragon. "And the Minoa tree, well, I don't know what she got. But we have what we came for, and that's what matters." The elves gathered alongside the path Eragon had chosen to follow and gazed at Eragon and Saphira with an intensity that made Eragon quicken his pace and the skin on the nape of his neck prickle. Not once did the elves speak, only stared with their slanting eyes, stared as if they were watching a dangerous animal stalk through their homes. A puff of smoke billowed from Saphira's nostrils. "If Galbatorix does not kill us first," she said, "I think we shall live to regret this."
Where did he say the pain was that he had in his stomach?
Eragon felt a slight twinge in his lower belly. He's pregnant.
Well, I was wondering if she, like, took his seed from him.
And his lower belly?
Well, that's what I was asking, like, where it was from.
If he felt, like, a twinge in his nuts.
Well, this is a children's story, so he can't be like, oh, I felt a twinge of pain in my nutsack.
Took his seed. Maybe, like, took his ability to even reproduce.
Oh, maybe. I don't know. I feel like it's going to be something reproductive related.
Lower belly. I guess that's, like, where the pelvis is. So that's, like, where the magic happens.
You know what I mean? Because I don't think she, like, put anything inside of him. Because, like, what good would that do unless she, like, put her seed into him and he's going to turn into a tree? But, like, that doesn't seem likely.
Or he's going to turn into a shrub. Goes from Eragon Shrub Slayer to Eragon Shrub.
Is a shrub. Dude, why the fuck did Saphira do that?
It worked.
At what cost, though? We don't even know.
Eragon probably just, like, can't have children now. Took the magic away from him. But, like, maybe to make the tree grow bigger, faster, further stronger. Out. Maybe Duweldon Varden now has, like, the seed of a man and, like, the, you know, like, there's a woman inside the tree. So now it's, like, going to be a giant forest. It's going to be fucking massive.
Maybe.
It's going to take over Alagazia.
Because the only thing I can think is that because her lover or whatever, like, didn't want her or whatever that
maybe
was,
she's
like,
gonna create her own lover out of his seed, Derek. Hi, I'm Derek. That's so Derek.
I feel like even though this is like an epic story, Eragon and Saphira are like still like fucking children.
James said Eragon Shrub Lair.
You know what I mean? Could you hear me? I said, like, even though this is, like, an epic fantasy adventure or whatever, it's, like, they're still children, like, Eragon and Saphira. You know?
Like, yeah, they're, like, getting close to 18, though, now. Like, very close.
Yeah, when I was 18, I was still a child. You know what I mean?
True. I'm still a child.
I'm 28 and still a child, so there's that. But, like, the fact that Saphira was like, well, I'm a dragon and you have to listen to me. And, like, basically, like, threw a fit and, like...
But it's like, calm down. Like, you're still a child dragon.
Yeah, like, I get it. But, like, that tree is so much bigger than...
And older.
And older than any creature, like, on the planet.
Like, his description earlier of, like, an ant banging its feelers on his boot. Like, mm-hmm. It's probably even less than that to her.
Yeah, like... And then Saphira would be like, well, I'm a dragon. And it's like, okay, well, that tree, like, is the planet. So I don't know.
But it worked. Like, they got the ore.
It worked. But at what cost? But at what cost?
Aragorn's virginity.
He's no longer pure and innocent. And what is he going to have to give to Arya? Nothing. He's been deflowered.
By the Manoa tree.
Oof.
That's a story to tell your grandchildren. I lost my virginity to the Manoa tree. How? I felt a weird tingling sensation in my lower abdomen. Dad, that's not how that works. It is what it is.
It's like, all I could think of was How I Met Your Mother. And, like, the end of that one, they're like, it sounds like a story about how much you love Robin. It's like, Dad, it sounds like a story about how much you love the Manoa tree.
She had sinuous body, if you know what I mean. She was dummy thick.
Whoa.
That tree spread for acres. Dad, wow. Calm down. The leaves, oh my God. Those limbs, oh, the curves.
Wow. When those roots, I don't know, fucking whatever. Anyway.
Good joke.
Thanks. I'm hungry. I can't think straight.
Yeah, all I can think about is food, but I don't know what to eat.
We have limited groceries, so.
We do.
There's that.
I guess I could have, like, a potato. Why are you laughing? I'm not joking.
Just, like, a potato. Like,
a potato.
I guess you could just eat a potato.
Sounds like a good lunch.
Yeah. It's weird.
All right, guys. Thank you so much for watching. I'm going to go eat a potato. Do you have anything else you want to input?
I really want to know what that tree took.
I don't think we ever find out. At least I don't remember. I have no idea. I'm as lost as you.
Hold on. Why did Eragon just say, yeah, I'll give you whatever you want without knowing what that tree wanted? What if she was like, I want you dead? What if that's what she wanted?
Here's your ore.
And then he fucking died. Like, why would you just be like, yes,
anything? Or what if she said, I want your dragon?
Yeah, like, what the
fuck? And he's
fuck?
Like, yeah, I'll take the ore. And she's like, here's your ore. And then, like, Saphira just turns into a dragon tree.
The roots just, like, and, like, suck her down.
Into he didn't know what kind of deal he made. I like that she was, like, very ominous and left it, like, open, like, then I'll have what I want. And then it's like, here's your ore, go. And he's like, but wait, what about what I owe you? She's like, go.
She's like, I already took it an hour ago.
What?
I don't know. I'm losing my mind.
That was weird.
Day two of quarantine.
Yeah, day two of quarantine. We're already like fucking freaking out. Okay, well, thank you guys for watching. Hopefully we see you guys in the stream. Scratch that. We will see all of you in the stream or else. check it out. We'll be multi-streaming. So we'll be streaming to Twitch and YouTube at the same time. But all the happening is going to be over on Twitch.
That's where we're going to be. Beep boop bopping.
That's where we're going to be focusing most of our like chat interaction and stuff. Most of it will be happening on Twitch for gaming purposes only. They just have like a better setup for streaming and stuff, you know?
Oh, man.
And plus, you can like get bits and stuff over there now. Not bits, channel points.
Oh, yeah.
Told and so that. Start earning them channel points because then you can like edit an emote. You can actually edit an emote.
Whoa.
That's cool.
Link in the bio?
Link in the bio. 100%. Goodbye. That phone call?
Yeah.
I can't hear what you're saying. Goodbye.
Oh my God. I'm hungry, but I don't want a potato.
What do you want?
Maybe more soup.
Pizza?
No, I don't want pizza. It's too cheesy.
Ew. Make